Got to record. That's good. What's in the chat box there? We're all good. We're going to have fun today. I love your background there, Annette. All those books.
Thank you. Thank you.
Absolutely. Sam Lewin, Jalen's. Come on, you guys. None of this hiding stuff. I need participation. There we go. There we go. Turn on that. There we go. Turn on those. Turn that on. Oh, we have a special. Oh, we got someone special coming on today. Everybody's special, of course. Everybody is special. But we have Mr. Justin. I can get it done. Chemnitz in the building.
What?
I loved your your latest YouTube. It was live the other day.
Yeah.
It was brilliant. I loved it. You were talking You were talking about the history of Justin. You were talking about, I didn't know it. You were talking about all the deals you were doing. You were talking about how your ex-wife didn't like the new home that you found.
Before. Right. So I had to get a new wife.
My wife's listening. I ain't going there.
Well, thank you for saying that, Uncle Claude. Appreciate that.
Yeah, you're good. Everyone, introduce your. If Justin is one of my superstars, he's one of these students who you share with him what works, you tell him what to stay away from, what doesn't work. You hope he doesn't make the same mistakes that I made. And this guy is brilliant. He just goes out and does it all the time. So
thank you.
I like doers. I like people who get stuff done. Tell everybody what you do and where you meet and yourself here.
Yeah, I'm just a normal guy like everybody. I put my pants on the same way. But
what's your pronouns?
Yeah, whatever was assigned to me. I don't know.
I'm sorry. It's one of those Mondays.
I'm a lease purchase specialist, so I practice lease purchase every day in my business. And so that means I'm helping sellers that can't sell or haven't sold and buyers that can't buy. And we make a beautiful marriage between the two, and I get paid handsomely for it when I do. So it's a great thing. And Uncle Claude, he's really helped me with that process, because before I met Uncle Claude, I didn't have the words. I mean, I was looking for the words, you know, like a man in search of a vision, stumbling around on the phone, saying this, that, the other thing, hoping that it fits, hoping that it works. But Uncle Claude's helped me solve those problems. So I'm very grateful for him.
I'm grateful to know you too. And behind every successful man is usually a smarter, more exhausted woman, and you have one there. Oh, my wife's cheering already. So.
I'm very blessed, very happy, happily married, very, very happy. Couldn't be happier if God would have let me put together the exhaustive list of everything I wanted. I could not have done as good as what he did by me with her.
Oh, I give him a round for that. Wasn't that was. Oh, you put Claudia. She went all the way up the stairs.
17 stairs to hear this.
Oh, my God.
It's good to see you, Claudia. I'm doing great. Great to see you.
Wasn't that nice what he said? Yes. You know, let's talk for a moment before we get into all the stuff today. Oh, by the way, Sunday I had an epiphany, a revelation, an aha moment. And I said, because a lot of people ask me, Claude, how do you make those cold calls and make them fun, make them personal? And Annette and I did a lot of practice on this last 2 weeks, and I made up a little mind map here. We're going to use that. But before I do that, a word from our sponsor. No, Justin, you know what I like? You take a lot of vacations. Let me just say it plain. There's a certain, why are we all doing this? Why are we in search of knowledge? Why do we want to be motivated? What is it we really want? We want the life. We want freedom, don't we? Right? Daytrim nodded his head. Thank you, my friend. I like those head nods. And Justin travels a lot. And every time I see Justin, he's taking another vacation. It's
I like
your
it.
travel agent must love you. You do a lot of vacations. Tell us about your lifestyle a little bit. I love the
Well,
lifestyle.
I live a modest lifestyle, really, honestly. My house is not a big giant mansion. I don't live in a castle or anything, but I do own a home, and I own it free and clear.
Whoa, that's
And
big.
yep,
That's big.
that's great. You never know true freedom until you can tell everybody to kick rocks. You know what I mean by that? Hey, I own my own house. I don't need y'all. I'll just go home, okay? And because of that, and because I don't get crazy with the lifestyle, like having to have a castle and having to have a new brand new car every single year that's top of the line,
Well,
it affords me freedom and the ability, because I make good money, to do whatever I want to do, which is ultimately what my goal has always been. My goal is not to be extravagant. My goal is to be free. I don't know if anybody can relate to that, but holy cow, that's been the desire of my heart my whole life. And so to have the level of freedom that I have, to where we can take a vacation every month or two, it's something that once you've had a taste of it, you'd do anything to keep.
one of my clients once said to me years ago, and I always remember this, and he said, "Claude, money makes a good man better and a bad man worse." Isn't that profound?
Oh,
Isn't that
yeah.
wonderful?
It's a
Money makes a,
magnifier.
yeah.
Yeah.
You know, the thing about it is always, we always hear a lot about Elon Musk and the richest people in the world and stuff. The media loves them and everything. How much money? But a lot of times we see they're not very happy people all the time, too. How much money do you need to be happy?
Great question.
How much do you need to be? I only had one goal in life, not to be in debt. Not to owe anybody anything, to be debt
Right.
free, mortgage, like you said, mortgage free, and to just if the funny thing is though, when you have your own business, I work much harder for myself than I ever worked for anybody when I was employed. Do you find that
Yeah,
too?
and you want to, that's the best part, really, is that when you work for somebody else, you got to clock in, you got to clock out, you got to be accountable with your time, and they always want the best part of the day, of your day. They always want the best part of your life. When you're in your prime, they want all of your best, and then they want to give you just what it takes to get by, so you'll come back and do it again for them tomorrow. And when you work for yourself and you have the ability to uncap your income, okay, and make as much as you want, sometimes you work hard because you just like it and you want it and it's addictive. In fact, if I don't do something productive in about 3 days, I start getting depressed.
Do you get mad at yourself? You get mad. I had a lull, like for I told this to you and to Brandon and a few other people. I had a lull for 2 weeks. I don't know what it was. Things were just too quiet. Guess who I got mad at? Do you think I cursed the
Right.
economy and the weather and the politicians and lawyers, and who do you think I got mad at?
Claudia.
Yeah, no. No. I got mad at I got a mad at myself, and last week was just a fantastic week for my business. We did a couple contracts, we signed up some new students. We just had a great week. We had a week that was equaled or greater than to somebody's annual income, that kind of a week. And when you're in this business, when you're in the real estate business, and you're not only doing deals, but you also have your own properties and you're renting, lease purchasing, you're creating notes. And then you get into the Mecca on the top of the mountaintop. You get into the information side of the business. You have multiple streams of income. How important is that in your business, Justin?
Yeah, I don't think you'll ever be free until you embrace this idea and then start to diversify a bit. Because what I've noticed is that no matter what you do, unless maybe you sell toilet paper, that's always in demand. But I don't know about you guys. I don't have a family that owns a toilet paper mill. So I basically just got into whatever business that seemed to fit me, which was sales. And it's like up and down like this, like a roller coaster. Some months I was doing great, and then other months it was in the pits. And then it would come back, and oh, I'd be so happy. And then, you know, it was just absolutely devastating emotionally to ride that roller coaster. That's why you find, I don't know if you know a lot of successful salespeople, but you should. And the successful ones that I know are drunks, and they're on drugs. And part of the reason why is because they're up, and then they're way down, and then they're back up again, and then they're back down, and they got to deal with that somehow. So, but when you diversify and you have more than one stream of income, like for example, consulting, coaching, in addition to doing real estate, then when one's up, the other one might be down, but that's okay because they kind of even one another out, and it makes life so much nicer. That's been my experience, at least, Uncle Claude. We've never talked about that though.
Yeah, it's a good topic. I think you're a product of your environment. You know, hang around. I like to hang around with up people, positive people. Okay. I like to make people smile, laugh, you know, no matter, even in business and stuff, is it okay to have fun while we're learning? Absolutely. You know, how many people have been to boring teachers, boring seminars, cures for insomnia? Okay. I mean, you know, learning should be fun. It should be interesting. It should be stimulating. We all had teachers in school. Who remembers the one? Don't we always remember the one great teacher, the one teacher who the class went so fast, and the other 75-85% of the teachers were yawn fests?
That's you, Claude.
Yeah.
That's you for me.
Don't we all remember it? How many people here still remember their kindergarten teacher? Mrs. Green, PS 152. Nobody else remembers their kindergarten or first grade teacher. Oh my God. I love that. Other than my mother, this was the second woman I fell in love with in my life. She told me she gave me milk and cookies and told me to take naps. I mean, come on.
That's beautiful.
Oh, it's the truth. You were talking about toilet paper before. You triggered a memory. This weekend we needed Claudia said I need Bounty towels, and she likes certain type of towels, the single sheets. Now, so anyway, I bought, guess how much 6 rolls of Bounty mega towels cost. This isn't your inflation moment. Does anybody take a guess? $22 for paper towels. When did paper towels get that expensive? When did everything get so expensive all of a sudden? I mean, I'm here in La La Land, and people are paying $5 to $6 and more in LA for just a gallon of gasoline. That costs more. When did gasoline become more expensive than beer?
Wow. Crazy. And you can't drink gasoline.
Yeah, no, but you need it. I always wonder. One of our conversations is a husband and wife, a normal family, 2.2 kids. They're both working. They're busting their butt. They got to commute. They got to drive to work. They got to pick up the kids from Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, Taekwondo, and all the things. And they got to fill up those cars at least 2 times a week. And that's got to be, there they go. Look at that, $22. There we go. We have totally unrehearsed here.
That's the quicker picker upper right there. Yeah,
yes, yes.
That's right. It even says it on here, Justin. The quicker picker upper. You're good.
Yes. Maybe they'll be our sponsor someday. Who knows? Anyway, thank you for the props, dear. You cannot plan these Mondays like this. Absolutely. But does anyone here notice how expensive things are? Have you, you know, has anyone gone out to dinner lately? It's a little crazy, right? So what's the solution, Justin? Make more money.
Make more money.
Make more money. Make more money than you need, but still live. What Justin said earlier, I thought was so important. How much bling do you need? How much tchotchkes? How much stuff do you need to be happy? You give me a good pair of running shoes, you know, and I'm a pretty happy guy. I can go out and take my runs, my walks, and stuff like that. That's, you know, give me a car that starts. I just I do lease my car and trade it in every 2 years, though. I will say that, Justin. That's the nice thing about having your own business and leasing a
Yeah.
car. You can write it off and you can get a new, I like that you can get a new car with new tires and new brakes every 2 years or three or whatever you want to do. And you get the latest safety features too. So that's my only gift. That's our gift to ourselves. A nice car. That I do like. Hey, who had six? Hey, let's talk about you guys. Open forum right now. Who's got a question? You got Justin here too. Ask him. There's a wealth of information here.
You're too kind, sir.
It's the truth. It's the truth. Learn from other people. Be in that environment with other successful, nice people. I think, like Frank Iglesias, who was so brave and turned on his video this morning. Look at him.
Look at me.
Look at you. How was your, you had some challenges last week. How did that work out?
We're a work in progress, but we're getting there.
Okay, good. Nice, safe answer there. Very, very safe answer.
I'm keeping it rated G.
Okay.
So.
Yes, family show. There's a little baby Alex on the screen there. How you doing, buddy? My youngest client. There he goes. Kid works for diapers. We're starting a used diaper business. You just turn them inside out, right? No way. Anybody, seriously, who had a good week? Who learned something last week? Bailey, you always have something to share. Who was your? Do you have any good sales calls last week, or was it a tough week?
Nothing's coming to mind last week. Who did I talk to last week? Yeah, I did. I had a couple good sales calls. I don't remember any specifics or anything, just normal stuff, you know. Normal Claude Diamond guts techniques always
Okay.
works. It was a good week though. Yeah.
It's a good week. Do you notice that when you use a sales system and hopefully your confidence is building and you're playing that role of a very successful, confident person, even if you're having a bad day or bad week, you're watching every penny. I've had times in my life like that. Is it still important to play the role of a confident, successful person when you're talking to a prospect? How big is that?
Absolutely, it's huge. That's what they're hoping to get from you, because
Yeah.
they want to buy from somebody that's just like a little bit above them, so to speak.
Absolutely. Yeah.
A pro.
Do you think when we're talking to a prospect, do you think they want to hear a sad sack or they want to hear somebody with some energy?
Energy for sure. The
Absolutely.
liveliness.
They want liveliness. They want, maybe they're having a bad week and they want your optimism, your energy. Okay. I absolutely think people do business with people they know and like, and that leads to trust. Okay. If you can make somebody smile, make them laugh, keep them motivated and interesting, what's the likelihood of doing business with that person in a competitive world, very competitive world? Jessica, I'll get right to you. Yeah. Got to make a difference. Jessica, go ahead. Or was that Alex who had his hand up?
Oh, no. I just wanted to. I know that we've talked about this book before. I think, Claude, you mentioned this book, but I've been reading it, and I just think it's like one of the best books to read, and it just gives you so much motivation and ideas, and it makes you think in a new way. The Compound Effect, Darren Hardy. I wanted to
Okay.
share that book. It's just amazing.
What's it about?
It's just about how getting your mindset into a more positive direction, and that creates a new path for your life to make it. And it can also work backwards if you're thinking negatively all the time, you'll perpetuate those negative thoughts, and then they turn into actions, and your life can go downhill. So it really teaches you how to turn around and think positive and be positive, not just in business, but in every aspect of your life. And I started reading it, and I was marking the pages that I thought were interesting, and I ended up marking almost every page because I thought there's a good tip in almost every page in this book. So I just wanted to recommend it and share it today. It's just a I mean, Einstein said, what is it? Here's, I got another quote to share with you. Had a bit of a sleepless night with the baby, so I'm
been there.
Compounding interest, one of the eighth wonder of the world. He who understands it earns it, and he who doesn't pays it. Well, if you can, I'll try to put this in the chat room, but.
There you go. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, definitely
put, Einstein. So
put that.
We knew he was kind of smart, right?
Yeah. A minister who wrote a very good book, I think in the late 50s or early 60s, Norman Vincent Peale, Positive Thinking. Okay. But is positive thinking enough? Brian Tracy, who I think one of the best books on success, The Psychology of Success by Brian Tracy. It's a wonderful book. It's very uplifting, motivating. But he says something in there. Every morning he chants his affirmations. Is chanting your affirmations, is that enough? To saying, hey, I like myself. I'm going to go out there. I'm going to crush the world. I'm going to do, if you just, you know, have that momentum, is that enough?
No.
Got to be a doer.
You got to act. You got to
get out of bed and get started.
Yeah. You got to do something. Okay. One of my tricks is I make a list every morning of things to do. I always talk about this. How many people here write down a list of 3, 4, 5, 10 things that they want to get done today? Okay. What is that organic, that good feeling when you cross them off? What is it about that? It's GSD, right? Cover Alex's ears. It's getting shit done. Okay. It's achievement, like getting things done. Over.
Yeah.
So even if it's simple things, you know, clean the toaster, you know, throw out the used dental floss, you know, and you check that off. There's a certain amount of satisfaction. I always, you know, rule of five, always talk about it. Okay. How many, can you talk to 5 people today? Can you make offers to 5 people? Can you offer something for free to 5 people? Can you interact, engage directly with 5 potential prospects a day? I don't care if they're cold, warm, follow up, or whatever. Can you do that? And some days I'll do 1 or 2. Some days I'll do 5. Some days I'll get to 10 or 15 people. Guess what happens to my business if that's part of my routine? Guess what happens?
It thrives.
If the forces of the universe, the math is in my favor. That is the consistent behavior. Yeah, that's my cheering squad there. Thank you. Good time. Very good timing, Alex. Excellent timing. How did he do that? Smart baby there. Absolutely. Another person I really like, Les Brown. How many people here have ever Les Brown? He is just, oh my God. He makes your, I mean, he gives you goosebumps. He's such a great speaker. You know, and Justin started out today, the conversation we had in the very beginning. Justin talked a lot about words, the right words at the right time, said the right way with the right volume. Okay, with the right enunciation, the right passion. How important are words? You know, when you're speaking, it's all about the words. It's all about the communication.
I had Chinese food the other day, Uncle Claude, and I got the fortune cookie, and in it was this fortune, and it said, "Your tongue is your ambassador."
Oh,
ooh!
And I kept that because I was like, that is exactly right.
Ooh.
How I represent myself to my clients, my customers, really all has to do with my tongue, doesn't it? Like what I say and how I say it. So, if you know, like you were saying earlier, if you got mad, you know, when you didn't have anything cooking for a couple of weeks,
yeah,
you know, you got to talk your way out of that.
You have to be your biggest fan. You have to be your own cheerleader in life. There's a lot of, oh my God, you turn on the, sometimes how many people here don't want to listen to the news sometimes? It's like, you know, it bums you out, doesn't it sometimes? You know, you got it. How do you stay positive in a negative world? You hang around with positive people. You exercise. I go out. I exercise every day. You guys know I'm an exercise nut. I run and swim every day. I go on the treadmill every day. I do stuff. I find that exercise stimulates endorphins, makes me feel good about myself. I play music. How many people play music every day? Does music lift you up? I always start and end this show, this get together with music. Music is something about music. Anybody ever, you know, what was that? Oh my gosh. Is the one movie where the guy's dancing in his underwear. Help me out.
Oh, Risky Business.
Risky Business. Yeah. Tom Cruise. Thank you. Thank you. You know, I mean, it's a fun scene. And I think he's singing into a spatula or something like that. It's just good stuff. I saw I see Alex has a post there. We're going to address it. Jessica, you had your hand up real quick.
I just thought I'd suggest for me, and I think Claude, you might agree with me that if everyone can work towards getting like one rental property instead of trying to make commissions, do your sales as well, but have the stability of at least one rental property where you know the rent's coming in every month. And you got to be a landlord, but it's so worth it. I think, in my opinion, it's so worth it to be a landlord and get that stability. Because I hear a lot of people talking about the roller coaster of sales. And so you can still do your sales, but you can also have one and then maybe even two rental properties. That's what brought the stability to my life. I had health issues to deal with and stuff. And by having those rental incomes coming in every month, you know, it was really worth it. And then you build equity over time. So just wanted to share that.
And Justin has a great video. Justin, if you find the link and you want to post it, it's great. He had a great video the other night on the properties and the deals he's done, how he built it up. You know, my first little property was a $25,000 condo. Okay. That eventually went up to, I think, $140,000. I refinanced it. I bought another one. Okay. And that started a chain of events. Yeah. For all kinds of properties. And all kinds of deals. It taught me, and the experience was the teacher. Having said all that, you know, renting properties and controlling tenants, especially here in the Soviet socialist state of Southern California, you know, who has the most rights, the tenant or the entrepreneurial husband and wife landlords?
The tenants do, but still, it's worth it still.
It's worth it, but you gotta get good information. Learn from somebody who's done it already to avoid the pitfall. A lot of I mean, if we had a seminar on just landlords, I'm sure we all have war stories. How many people here have met the tenants from hell? Marty and Morticia Satanowski. That was their real names. Okay, the tenants from hell. You know, there are people out there that don't think they have to pay rent, and it's okay to damage and punch holes in your walls and things like that. It's tough. Frank, I know you've got war stories like that too.
So we just got rid of somebody that was on a lease option, and we evicted them, but they still owe us money, so they think it's done, but we're going to chase them down, and if for no other reason than fun, but it's several thousand. So I'm like, all right, it's worth a little bit of effort.
Yeah. And sometimes, by the way, just because is my legal hat on right now. Just because they owe you money and you want to go to court to get your revenge doesn't mean, even though you'll get the judgment, doesn't mean you'll ever get the money from them, by the way, because they go through life that way. There's some people with a concept of,
yeah, we know.
Yeah, you know, so
we've done the judgment thing where you get it, garnish, send them to collections, and you never get it all, but if we get some, we're good.
Yeah, you get some, and there's something about an emotional satisfaction. But you know, there's bums out there, and there's a way to avoid the bum tenant. By the way, the word I hear a lot right now on the internet, on YouTube, I love YouTube, is squatter. Are you guys hearing a lot about squatters and squatters' rights? And it seems people who leave their homes, okay, other people are just moving in, and taking over at home. Don't ask me what I would do about, knock on wood, I'll never have that problem, but don't even ask me what I'd do if I ever discovered someone broke in my home and decided they could live there. You know, that seems to be the operative word right now. Anybody have a comment or a story on that?
I just experienced this on a deal last month, Uncle Claude. Really? I was putting together a lease purchase deal in California, and I would have thought it would have gone a different way. But however, right before the tenant buyer and the seller were signing the, you know, I was assigning my position to the tenant buyer when I was making the marriage, I was actually going for signatures. If we were this close to closing, the next step was to get a wire transfer for my paycheck and for the seller's, what he was getting for initial payment. And so I get a message from the tenant buyer saying, hey, there's somebody at the property that's moved in and is, it looks like they're stripping the house too of everything of value also. And I was like, oh my gosh, what in the world? Right now before payday. And so turns out, cops came out, pulled guns on the guy, had him surrounded, drug him out of the house, and, everything went to plan. So we closed and got paid. It was one of the weirdest experiences of my real estate career. And I've been doing this a while, but I would have never guessed that the police would have went out there and done that. But they did that. I can't explain it because I see what TV says too. And they look like, it looks like squatters are being allowed to live in people's homes all over the country. And in, especially maybe in California, but somehow I got lucky. So thank you to the El Mirage, California Police Department. Hats off to you, sirs.
Yeah, send them a donation. Absolutely. By, you know, a Florida just, I believe the governor, somebody can help me on this. I believe the governor just gave the police the powers to throw out bums, squatters in properties where they're obviously, where the owner can prove they have no lease or no equitable standing in the property. They just broke in and are living in there. I think that's there's a reason why Florida is so successful lately economically. I'm sure Texas probably is going to do something or have something like that too. Yeah, you were lucky. California.
Very lucky.
Yeah, absolutely.
Send them a month's worth of Krispy Kremes, Justin. cops love donuts.
That's hilarious.
Very good. Hey, I've got a text here I want to acknowledge from Alex. Alex, are you still with us? Let me see. Are you on the screen? There. Where are you? There you are.
Here, brother. Sorry, I'm cooking and eating lunch here. So.
Okay. You said, what do you guys think about this text message? I'm starting to send previous leads who reached out and expressed interest about storage coaching. What do you like or dislike? Would you change anything? You want to read it to the group there, Alex?
Yeah, let me bring it up here. So,
in my mind.
Hey, brother, wanted to ask you a small favor. I recently created a valuable presentation on how to find fun and profit from a cash-flowing self-storage facility within 6 to 12 months without using your money or needing any experience. And I was hoping I could send it to you to get your feedback. I'm being asked to speak to more audiences about the opportunity with self-storage, and would really value your feedback from someone who has expressed interest but not in the business or might still have questions about what's possible through storage. Would you be willing to watch it and let me know what you think? It's around 40 minutes or so. If you don't have the time, no worries at all. But if you do, let me know and I'm happy to share with you valuable storage resources I use in my business as a thank you.
What do you guys think before I venture here? What do you think about that marketing? That's a text message for marketing, correct?
Correct.
Anybody have an opinion?
Well, I think it's okay if it's people who showed interest previously. It's another way to, you know, tap into them and start conversation.
I like that too, Dave. I think I like the heart of what he's saying. It feels a little wordy to me, but that's only because I'm a tight ass. I know every text message I send off my platform costs a certain amount of money, so I try to keep things under 160 characters. But yeah, anything to get them on the phone, because your ultimate goal here would be what Uncle Claude says. Once you get them on the phone, is to say, "Oh, okay, now, Alex, I've made a decision." And boom, there you are. Okay.
Exactly right, Justin. Just for a little bit of context for everybody, these are, I don't want to call them cold leads, but I would, they're not hot. They're probably warm, right? They've come into my system over the course of the last 3-4 months. In some cases, I've had a hard time getting them on a phone or getting them to commit to a time. So I'm just trying to re-spark their interest and get them on the call. And it is a valuable resource that I can share with them. So I'm just trying a different approach outside of calling them, outside of doing some of the things I've been doing. So that's what, and I was just hoping to get your feedback on kind of like the copy aspect of it, the psychology. How does it come across? Does it come across genuine, sincere?
Anybody else before I chime in here? I like what you have, but two words that turned me off: 40 minutes.
Okay.
Oh my God, 40 minutes out of my day. Oh no. If I wouldn't put the time frame in, as you guys know, I even have it here on my notes here for today's, we're going to get to this in a minute. Do you have a minute? When I get a live person on the phone, I'm trying to interact with somebody, I never set a time frame because I don't want to scare them off, either 1 minute, 3 minutes, or 40 minutes. So I, and this is subjective. You don't have to take everything I say as gospel, but that's the one thing. I would also shorten it. I would say I would say, hey, I'm working on something new on storage, and I'm working on a new project, a new book, a new something, a new outline. I'd love you to see my notes or share with me your thoughts. Could I get some feedback or your opinion on this? I could consider it a personal favor. Thank you. You know,
create a little mystery in it to intrigue them. Maybe I should watch this or check it out.
Here's something you might be interested in. Here's something I knew I'm working on. I had an epiphany the other day while I was shaving, and I'd love to know what you know, the secrets of investing in storage centers. And I think I made up a simple outline. Could you give me your feedback on that?
Okay.
Got it. I think summed up, I would say less is more. Do you think people read? I know we write, you know, sometimes I get marketing pieces and they're long, long pieces. Have we all gone to web pages that you just scroll and scroll and scroll? Do you think people really, how long do you think people stay on that scrolling?
One paragraph.
Yeah. I mean, do you think and you guys can disagree with this, do you think we're in a society where people want to DQ it, do it quick? They don't, the stuff that we think is gold, maybe they only want to, I think we got to pull in people in terms of marketing. I think we need to pull in people in the first 15 seconds. We've got to say something. Go ahead, Chris.
Goes back to your elevator speech from last week.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Alex, something that's worked really well for me is taking what Claude said and then putting it into like a Facebook post to get people to reach out to you. So like, give an example, like I'm thinking about putting together a checklist on how to blank in blank time or less. If you'd like a copy of the checklist when it comes out, you know, comment me and just comment me, right? And all the people that reach out, now that's warm, they're reaching out to you, then you can go ahead and reach out to them and kind of follow up. But saying the same thing to people when you call them, say, hey, I'm thinking about, you know, putting together this guide, or I have this guide, love to get your feedback on it. What's the best email to send that out to? Or can I get that over to you and hear your thoughts? It would really mean a lot, and it would help me out a ton.
Love it. Love it. Awesome. Yeah. Thanks, Chris. But I'm no C, man.
Yep.
I mean, all right. reverse engineer it is one of the tricks I do. Put yourself in the shoes of the potential prospect, okay? If you were that person and you got this thing and it's a long text and it says, I need 40 minutes of your time.
Yeah, yeah.
How many, you know, do you think lot of people say, hey, I'm busy and everything, and this is just, this is a sales guy trying to trap me or something like that. You see, I always think about making it into a gift or an incentive or a reward or sharing, like Dave said, share the secret. There's a nice trick. a little trigger word. Somebody else had their hand up. Who, Jessica? Or was that a leftover hand? Okay, I see the hand up here. Let me take it down. There we go.
If they're gonna, if they start watching it and they're into it for past a minute or two, they're gonna stay for the whole 40 anyway.
What makes what is the thing? Okay, Jessica, you were muted before. I saw you. You're still muted. We can't hear you. There you
just,
go.
This was from way back when we were talking about being a landlord. A very good friend of mine who's a lawyer, he said, stay out of court unless you absolutely have to go to court. And I learned that. I've only been to court once in my 20-year real estate career. And I always just negotiate with if there is a problem and you screen your tenants really well, then you often don't get any problems. But if you do get a problem, you just negotiate it out of court. And sometimes you give them a bit of money and just pay it forward and, you know, tell them to pay it forward and you're done.
Yeah.
So that's how I handled it. So that's all I wanted to say about that.
Yeah. Here's the thing with court. Even when you win, you lose.
You do.
Yeah. It's let's forget about cashing in on the judgment and everything else.
Right.
How much emotional negative time? How many times do you vent and you talk about it and you lose sleep over something that stresses you out? I'll get that person and everything. And it just drains you. And if you weigh that against what you could use that time and energy and good sleep instead, I know that, you know, it's just, is it really worth the time and trouble? How do you get do you find the perfect tenant? Okay.
You do a lot of screening.
You do some screening. So my mentor used to always say success and failure always leave clues. When you got a tenant, what do you look for when you're real quick here? Cause time is going so fast today. When you're looking for the perfect tenant, what do you look for? What's the clues that you can find out about a person? Credit, you know, of course
you're asking me. Yeah. Your credit for sure. Like, they got to have a good history with money. And then also they good communicators, you know, will they pick up the phone at certain points to discuss things and will they bring you that deposit right away? And usually you're good to go. I've only had like a handful of like a few bad tenants in a long, long career of being a property manager and landlord. So.
Yeah. You check their, first of all, confirm their employment. Look at their employment history. There are some people out there, they change their jobs like you change your socks, okay?
Yeah. Okay,
that's a clue right there. The credit history, hey, you know, and they'll come to you, oh, no, I'll pay you, I'm a person of my word and everything. Well, you didn't pay MasterCard, you didn't pay General Motors, you didn't pay your electric bill a year ago, or why am I different? Character, you know, you can tell something about their character based on their credit score, of course, their job history and things like that.
And you can do an eviction history and criminal history. You're legally allowed to do that as a landlord.
Yeah, you got to be so careful because you're putting one of your most valuable assets, the things you've worked so hard for. Okay. Claudia and I, when we first started in this business, I mean, there were weekends where we were painting, cleaning carpets, and then we moved somebody in who had a good line of, they had a good line, okay? And what happens when you let that person into your house and you find out, uh-oh, you know, all of a sudden the rent is late, it's late 2-3 days, then it's late 5 days, then the following month it's 15 days, then eventually they call you, oh, Claude, my wife's never been to Mexico, so we're going to have to hold off this month on the rent. You know, whose fault is that?
It's yours.
Yeah. You got to, and when you get a tenant, you got to have the conversation, okay? Yeah. It's almost like teaching your kids the birds and the bees or something like, you've got to have, sit down and have a conversation. Mr. and Mrs. Tenant, we're on a honeymoon right now. You're moving in and I'm glad to be doing business with you, okay? But the rent is due on the 1st. It is late on the 2nd. You get a phone call from me on the 3rd and we file an eviction on the 5th if our jurisdiction will allow that. And I just want you to know that, okay? So don't call me up and tell me your grandmother wants to become your grandfather or have surgery. Okay. Oh boy, that was, where did that come from? but the thing, But the thing is, you have
that. The visual. Oh my God.
No visuals allowed. Let's talk. Let's go into here before we run completely out of time. Hey, Mr. Brent Bowers, the Land Shark, has joined it. All the superstars are on today. Wow. Chris Logan and Justin and Brent. You're all superstars, in my opinion. But Brent, real quick, how's your world, man? Haven't seen you in a while.
Really good. I've been taking a lot of time off, so it's time to make some money. I've spent a lot of money these past 6 weeks, and I got to make some now. So I got to get back on the phone. Justin, let's do a live event. Claude, let's do a live event.
Let's do it, dude.
Let's go. I'm ready to bring in some land sharks. What's really cool is, like, our land sharks are having so much success so fast. And the program's open. I got a few more spots, and it's time to fill them. And I need to get back to work. I need to follow up what the stuff that Claude talks about every day, five times. I've already made one offer today. I got four more to go before I go to sleep tonight. So make offers, and I got to make some money again. I see that Claude's payment keeps coming out of my bank account, so I better come do some work.
Yes. Oh, by the way, we were talking before you came on the squat. You live in Florida. Tell us about that new squatter law that the governor just signed.
I don't know anything about it, but I know I'll send people with baseball bats to beat doors down if I have to in Florida to get people out. We won't hit anybody, but we'll scare them. No, I'm just kidding. I don't know anything about it. I don't have a ton of rentals in Florida except for industrial and commercial, and those are so much easier. I'm buying another industrial building right now, and I already have a four-year lease signed on it. I don't even own the building yet.
They're beautiful, beautiful. Chris, I saw your hand up or a reaction there before. Unmute yourself.
Yeah, no, I haven't dove into the law wholly 100%, but I can tell you that it's a big win for Florida because it ends the long battle to get people out of properties. It's been ridiculous to get them out of properties, and this is supposed to make it a lot easier. So I don't know all the ins and outs of it yet, but I do know that it's a big win for Florida.
Okay. I think it's just such a smart rule. I just love when the government it's so rare when your leaders have enough common sense to protect the people who create the economy that gives all these jobs and makes everything thrive, okay? You know, California is, I'm not going to get too political here. California is chasing people out of the state, the doers, the people who find properties, fix them up. They're taking away all the incentives and the rewards from people who work so hard. You know, I'm a capitalist. You know, I think Benjamin Franklin said it was the worst economic system in the world, but there's nothing better. Okay. When you have people who are high, you know, are part of the solution, who are creating industry and economy, and they buy things and they hire people, that's what makes the economy thrive. Okay. But when you chase those people out because you're favoring other people who don't contribute, it doesn't make any sense. So I love to hear when Florida does smart stuff like that. I'm sorry, I'm too political today. I have the little mind map. I wanted to talk about it, breaking the cold call wall. You guys can interrupt or whatever if you have a question. Bottom line, how do you turn a cold call into a warm call? How do you call somebody up? A lot of you do marketing, you buy lists, you do scraping. Not so much. You go on to you get a list from the MLS. You go on to Zillow and Redfin and Trulia, and those are kind of lukewarm calls because they're advertising, or Facebook. You find people all the time. How do you call them up and not sound like a robot or sound like a? Do you think sounding like a salesman will get you 99% rejection? Absolutely. So how do we get somebody so they don't make an instantaneous negative judgment on us? We do different things, like we do familiarity. Okay, so if I call up Chris Logan, ring ring, Chris.
Yeah, hey, this is Chris.
Hey, Chris, it's Claude, man. I'm sorry it took me so long to call you. Hey, buddy, how's the family? How's everybody doing?
Oh, it's going good.
who the hell are you? You know, right?
Yeah.
But
yeah, who are you again?
Yeah, yeah. I'm Claude Diamond. You know, listen, so sometimes I'll segue and I'll combine some of these. I'll do familiarity and then I'll go, I'm confused, or I'll go to apology or even referral. So if I called up Chris, how's everybody doing? I'm so glad I got you on the phone. Chris, I'm a little confused. I got your phone number here on a post-it. Okay. And I've been moving this back and forth on my desk. I'm sorry. Why are we talking today? This isn't about real estate, is it?
Well, I am in real estate. I'm not sure why the post-it's there, but you know, I'm in real estate.
Oh, okay.
Not sure what it could be.
I don't either. Are you looking? So a lot of people call me because they want me to buy something or they want to sell me a property. Well, that isn't what we're talking about today, is it?
Yeah, I actually have a property that we're looking to unload here in Tampa, Florida.
Oh, but it's sold already. It's probably in, you've got a contract by now, right?
No, we don't actually. It's still available.
You know what? Can I ask you 2-3 quick questions? And you ask me a few and I'll make you an offer and maybe we'll move forward or maybe it'll be over.
Sure. That sounds good.
Oh, you're the best person. I've had a tough day today. Thank you so much, man.
Yeah, no problem.
You're nice to me. Thank you. Okay. Off the role play. I went from familiarity. I am confused. I even did an apology. Yeah, I'm so sorry. I'm so embarrassed. Boom.
Gotta be a thespian.
You've got to be authentic. You've got to be a thespian. You've got to be very relaxed. You got to be in that frame of mind where, do you think sometimes people can tell what the phone call's about by our tonality, by the way we sound? Okay. I have this thing. I get a lot of people call me up. Hi, how are you today? What goes in your mind when you hear that right away?
Scripted salesman,
right? So if I call somebody up, hi, Justin, ring, ring.
Hello.
Hey, Justin, Chris Logan. You don't know who Chris is. Chris Logan told me to give you a call, man. Maybe you can help me with this problem.
Okay. How do you think I might be able to help?
Chris said great things about you. And Chris said that you buy I got this one property here and I'm trying to set it up as a lease purchase and I need a contract. Can you help me?
I don't know. Claude. I guess it depends. I mean, you'll have to tell me more about what the opportunity is, and then I'll tell you. I'm probably going to ask you a couple questions, and you can ask me a few. And if it's not a good fit, we'll just decide that we'll both tell each other no. Is that okay?
That's great. Boom. Don't off the role play. Brilliant, by the way. Do you see how Chris and Justin, how these guys go all into they use the gut system. They go right in the beginning there to agenda. You've got agenda is a psychological move of asking permission, making them feel important, telling them the rules of the game, how we're going to play. Maybe doing a little stroking and nurturing. Thank you so much, by the way. And then give them a reward. Tell them you're going to make them an offer at the end of the phone call. Who cares what the offer is? Do you think they get a lot of people who call them up and say, I'll make you an offer? No. Okay. And that's, so they may think they got a serious prospect on the phone. What were the three words that Justin said that were the most important in that role play?
I don't know.
I love you.
you can say that. You can say that too. But you might go into the weird land then. Okay. But when you say to some, why do salesmen always think they need to know the answer for everything? What happens when someone asks you a question? Okay, they're trying to control the conversation, and they just want to ask you one question after another. We've all met that dude or dudette. Okay, when you go back to, I don't know, I'm not sure what you mean. Could you go into more detail? Why did you bring that question up? Could you help me? I'm not sure what you mean.
Wasn't that a whole lot simpler than the Grant Cardone 10-volume set of rebuttals?
Yeah, well, the thing about the rebuttals and scripts are, how do you remember all that stuff? Hold on, I'm going to go to page 894 so I know the 10x response. Nothing against Grant, by the way. I'm a big fan. I think, whatever the guy does, he's a hell of a businessman. The thing about it is, saying what's the opportunity if we can call somebody and convert that cold call to a warm and engage in a conversation? How does that change the opportunity for us?
It makes it to where it's instantly available on demand.
Yeah. How about
there's a saying by who was it? Either Napoleon Hill or W. Clement Stone, where there's, I think it was Stone, where there's nothing to lose by trying and everything to gain if you're successful. By all means, try.
Yeah.
So it's like you're making that cold call, and it's not really anything warm. You're creating the warmth, but you're also giving them the opportunity to say no right off the bat. Hey, if it doesn't work, you know, that's fine too.
So when you're making cold calls, you've got to experiment with this stuff. Try different things that fit your mood, your personality. Have fun with it. Go into IDGASL, okay? I don't give a shit, Lamb. Just go into it. What's the worst that could happen? They don't like you. They hang up. They're you know, whatever. But is there an opportunity when you engage another person and they're not sure who you are? So they're is this somebody I know, or is this just a cold call salesman? When you create that little bit of doubt, do you have an opportunity? And that's the why we have to do these kind of different pattern interrupts with people. Can we call somebody up? Ring, ring, Brent Bowers.
Hello, I couldn't answer the phone. Here we are.
Hey, yeah. Hey, Brent. Oh, is this Mr. Bowers?
Yeah, people call me Brent, though.
Brent, I just saw your YouTube videos. Can I get your opinion on something?
I don't know, man. I got to go in about 3 minutes. I got to
It'll go really quick. I mean, I love your videos. I watch everything you do, man. I think you walk on water.
Oh, I'm so humbled. I definitely don't walk on water. But yeah, how can I help you? I got like 2 minutes left.
Oh, boom. I'm in. Okay. I'm in. So the thing about it is, did anyone hear any stroking in there, by the way? Do compliments work? What do you guys think? Give me some feedback here. Do compliments work?
Yeah, people like feeling good about themselves. And when you recognize something good in them, it makes them feel more comfortable.
When you go... I think, you know, we don't compliment people enough. When you go to somebody and you make them feel good, or you say, I'm a big fan, I love your videos, I love your work. Oh, Justin, that background you have with the American flag and the dartboard, I can obviously tell you put a lot of time into the sandwich zone. that's such good stuff. When you acknowledge people, tell me that isn't a powerful persuasion technique.
Giving somebody you know, I only have 2 minutes. 2 minutes is a long time to get a lot of information and questioning out. You can do the weather in 2 minutes.
What can we do in that 2 minutes? If we know you're, listen, back into it, Brent. Hey, Brent, I know you're busy and everything like that. I'm working on a project here that deals with a financing land. And I have some great ideas, and I wanted your feedback because you're the man and everything. Is there a way we could talk for 5 minutes later today?
Yeah, absolutely. And I applaud you for doing your creative finance deal. I'm super intrigued. Let me see if I can get my wife to schedule push back my other meeting. Hey, love, will you push the other meeting like 4 minutes? I've got a guy on here I'm really fascinated to hear about. Go ahead, Claude.
Boom. It's not
wow, that was really cool. Hats off Justin, to you, Brad.
I feel like you just stroked and nurtured me. I mean, coming from you, man, I'll tell you, that's a compliment.
Just stop already, all right?
So say now, a lot of times, at least 50% or a great deal more, we call up people, we get voicemails. Can we use this same breaking the cold call wall with the voicemails we leave? How many people leave a voicemail? Hi, I saw your ad and everything. I'm just calling to ask you a few questions, and we don't get a response, right? Because we're not the only person who called. They get a lot of Looney Tune people who call, okay? You think I'm exaggerating about the response rate on general voicemails? They're very low, right? What's the goal? Can we get them to pick up the phone and call us back? But sometimes we leave, somebody give me a beep. for a voicemail on a toll call.
Beep.
I need the beep. I'm sorry. Hey, hey, Justin, this is Claude Diamond. Listen, I'm sorry it took me so long to get back here. I've got the paperwork in front of me here. And before I send it off, I just wanted to talk to you. Give me a call as soon as you get this message, man. Okay. 619-206-5960. Hey, best of the family, buddy. Boom. Now you're going to go, who the hell is, what paperwork? Who is this guy? You're going to be confused. Is it going to drive you crazy, Justin? It wouldn't for me.
I don't know. I would be skeptical maybe a little.
Okay.
Because I don't know what paperwork is out there, and there might be some paperwork floating around out there that I don't want to talk about.
Okay. But I also, sorry it took me so long to get back to you, if you remember that part. And I also said best to the family. What is that? What does that put in your head there when I say things like that?
Yeah, it breeds a familiarity into the conversation. Like perhaps we know one another. We've talked before. You know more about my intimate life than, let's say, someone else would, you know.
We're trying to raise curiosity. Okay, it's not foolproof. But if I leave a different kind of voicemail, it stands to reason that maybe I'll raise the curiosity of Justin and he'll call me back. Will he call me back being skeptical? Possibly, because he's feeling a little manipulated. And then we have
sure.
But do we win if he calls me back? Absolutely. And then we have to go into what is called fix it mode. Okay. Here, how do we do fix it mode? Go ahead. Call me back, Justin, and be a little skeptical. Ring Diamond Consulting Group. This is Claude. How may I help you?
Hey, Claude, Justin Chamness here. I got a message from you earlier today about some paperwork. And, you know, frankly, please forgive me, but I'm really not sure what we're talking about or what this is even concerning. So can you fill me in on this?
I don't know. I'm sorry. I make so many. I have so many deals and I'm calling so many people. And sometimes I take a stupid pill. Your name again was?
Justin Chamness.
Oh, this isn't about real. This is a lot of people call me about real estate and land and storage centers. And what business are you in, Justin?
Well, Claude, I'm looking to contract some property deals at great value. You don't have anything.
You're looking to buy?
Well, not if you just have retail stuff. I mean, I'm looking for discount property deals here. Is that something that you have, or is this maybe not the right?
You know, I get those kind of deals on my desk all the time. I was just talking to Dave Skolnick about a piece of land in Rancho, California. Give me an idea what you're looking for. How much under market? And are you talking about cash or financing? Give me a little idea what you're looking for. Maybe we can do business.
Okay. In a nutshell, I need it to be a discount deal because I'm a cash buyer. Claude, I'm the most serious cash buyer you've talked to this week. And I am ready to pull the trigger on a discount deal. So if you've got something, you know, that's, let's just say, round about 60% of after repair value, then I would love to take a look at that and make an offer immediately. If you have anything that's retail where the homeowner is flexible and willing to do terms and take their, you know, their payments over time instead of all cash up front, then I would also take a look at those. Do you have those, Claude, or is this over?
No, I see we got two gut salesmen here. He used the line, is it over? I love that. Good, very good. The bottom line is, it was a cold call. I left a cryptic and hopefully a curiosity type of voicemail, and Justin called me back. Was I able to fix it and get him talking to me? And this is the whole premise of a successful business. How many people can we engage? Can we engage strangers by acting and sounding different, leaving different messages?
Okay. You got his whole parameters from him in 30 seconds.
Yeah.
You got him to open
30
up.
Seconds. That's remarkable.
Yeah. But if they call you back, you win. Okay. How many of you guys have been stuck texting back and forth to your thumbs start hurting? Is that how you do business? Is that how you're going to get a signed contract today? Texting should be a prelude to a phone call, or better yet, a Zoom call. You get on Zoom and you get that face-to-face. You are now in the perfect electronic environment for closing. Absolutely. Anybody else want to have the last word? We're out of time. It went fast today, huh? Daytrium, we didn't give you a chance to talk. Or Annette, you guys have any comments or questions?
Oh, to be honest with you,
don't be honest. Oh no.
Okay, to lie to everybody. No, today was very powerful. I really appreciate Justin and Chris and was it Brent and, you know, and everybody that shared. It was very interesting to hear what you had to say. Yeah, very powerful stuff, you guys.
Thank you. Good. You made me feel good.
Yeah, success. When you talk with successful people, and you know the people in this room are real, okay? And they have no other agenda than to share what they're doing right, stay away from the mistakes. And it always, to me, it's always about being, practicing, and being better at your craft and working on it every day. Annette, the young lady in the room, the other young lady, anything you'd like to share? You're muted. There you go.
Yeah, no, this was really good. Really good. It's one thing to get it from you, Claude. It's also good to see how it's applied and others are using it. You know, it becomes hearing it, seeing it, and then doing it, of course, is what makes it ours.
It's real when you hear, I agree, thank you. It's real when you hear it from other people, right? And those people have found the secret to having the freedom, the life they want. And you know, a lot of, hey, you know, deep down inside, I'm still an insecure little bunny rabbit inside. But I learned that if I could get comfortable speaking to more people, I know what I'm talking about. I know my strategies, my product, my services. I know how to solve people's problems. I know how to do marketing, attraction, warm marketing. But it always comes down to, what do you need to do today to go to the bank? What do you need to do, Frank, to go to the bank today?
Need to call some people.
Yeah, talk to a few people. Jalen's with that beautiful San Francisco bridge behind you.
Yeah, what was your question?
There was none. What's your opinion about today? Did you learn anything, or was this just a rah-rah session?
No, it was good. I appreciate all you guys' time and you know, sharing what works and how I can apply it. So thank you.
How many people are you going to talk to today?
5.
Okay, good. I don't care if it's a Walmart greeter. Even on days when we have busy days, we have other things in life. Okay, we have the kids, we have dentist appointments, all those things. Can we still practice our craft when we engage other people day to day? You know, and you get so good at it. Just to make another person smile or like you or know who you are. And then when it transposes to the business calls all day long, someone is ready to say yes today. Somebody wants to give you a contract, an appointment. Someone wants to give you a credit card or a master or a debit card or cash. Can you still use cash anywhere anymore? Has anyone ever gone to a place where they don't accept cash anymore? That's kind of crazy, isn't it? It really is. You guys are great.
It is crazy.
It is crazy. Oh, we don't take cash. We need a debit card. Where was that? I'll think about it and I'll tell you next week. You guys are great. Have a wonderful, prosperous, healthy week. And we'll see you next week, okay? Everybody, take care. Thanks for joining us.
Great session, Claude. Thank you.
Thank you.
Love you, Uncle Claude. Thanks,
love you
everybody.
Guys. Be good. Here we go.
See ya.
Here's the new one. This is the new one from Apple. Well, if we can also do this one, then we can do this one. And then we can do the old fireworks. But what we never want is this one. There you go. Have a great week, everyone.